in Asheville, North Carolina, and it's also now broadcast on Saturday at 9 a.m. You can also listen online at www.wpvmfm.org, or you can watch us on live at Facebook Live, and we'll say, Jeff, you can say hello to all the folks out there in Facebook Live world. Each week we focus on the Asheville theater scene, as well as on positive news and information about people and organizations in the Asheville area. And toward that end, it's my pleasure to introduce you to my first guest, Jeff Cadenese. Jeff is the Artistic Director for Attic Salt Theater Company, and welcome aboard, Jeff.
No, thank you so much.
Okay, I don't like how your mic sounds, but I think we got it now.
There. Ah, there I am.
Okay, you can hear yourself. And Jeff is a friend of mine. He's also an amazing guy. He's a writer, director, and author, lives in Asheville. Not only is he with Attic Salt Company, he's co-author of 3 drama education books for Scholastic Incorporated. Recently, Jeff has directed Romeo and Juliet for Montford Park Players, The Man Who Came to Dinner for Asheville Community Theater, Gruesome Playground Injuries for Attic Salt Theater Company. In addition, Jeff, you're also a star on Jeopardy. You were just on Jeopardy.
Yes, I am a star on Jeopardy. Okay. I was on for one day.
Did you enjoy that?
I'll tell you how I did. I enjoyed playing. Yeah. I mean, you know, I've been playing at home since I was a kid, so it was great to
And is that what told you you knew you wanted to be on it, because you had always played as a kid?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, when I was a kid, I had a penchant for useless knowledge. And, you know, always wanted to be on Jeopardy and took the online test every year and finally made the cut.
Jeff, one of the things that knocks my socks off about you is that you seem to do a lot of things almost simultaneously, you know?
Yeah.
and aside from directing, you also act in a bunch of stuff, and mm-hmm. That's where I think I first met you as an actor, and I just love watching you on stage. Do you have a preference, acting or directing?
Directing, definitely.
It's funny, most people who do both tell me that. Why is that so?
Directing, I think, first of all, there's the joy of being able to feel finished with a project, like opening night, 7:30 or whatever the opening time is. I'm able to kind of wash my hands and say it is now the SM show. My work here is done. And I enjoy that aspect of it. But mainly, it just suits my personality better. You know, a lot of actors who become directors are that actor. They're difficult, to use a word. I had enough directors say to me, well, if you think you can do it better, why don't you do it? And it's kind of like, yeah, I do think I can do it better. So I did it.
One of the toughest challenges I imagine you ever had as a director, and you somehow carried it off, was when you did The Man Who Came to Dinner.
Mm-hmm.
And let's talk about that one, because that's a little short play, you know, just, it's not a short play.
Short play, it's a long play.
Yeah, play. And then all of a sudden, you were directing it, doing a great job, and your actor got sick or whatever, couldn't mm-hmm. come through the main lead. How'd you handle that one?
The lead during, just before tech week, just before we went into tech, my lead told me that due to a medical issue, he was unable to continue, and I very quickly thought about it, and I said, okay, in order to get this show up in a week, the only person who knows all the blocking and some of the lines was me, and luckily, I feel comfortable as an actor, and I knew I was going to have to be on book for the run. But even so, it was kind of, to me, it was a no-brainer, because even though I know so many talented actors and a lot came right out and said, I'll do it, to spend the extra time to reteach the blocking and get them integrated with the cast and all that was just too time-consuming. So I said, you know what, I'm just going to take it on. And I had to juggle my schedule like crazy, but I was able to do it.
So. Well, I think it carried it off for 2 reasons. One, the part was almost perfect for you. You know, if ever there was a part.
A curmudgeonly.
older guy.
You know, older guy, wait a minute.
No, in the show he's older, right? But you carried that off. But also, very effectively, even though you were kind of reading parts of the script. Explain how you were able to carry her up because of your character in that show was in a wheelchair.
Luckily, the character spends almost the entire play, other than one little tiny scene in the middle, and then the end spends the entire play in a wheelchair. So what I did was I just, because the character was a writer and radio personality, I said, you know what? He's constantly journaling, and he has a journal in his lap. And that was able to allow me to have the script right in my lap. And by the second week of the run, even though I felt like I had the lines pretty much down, it was very comforting to have it there.
This was incredible being in the audience. I kind of knew that the backstory, but I couldn't really tell. You know, you're just talking to this guy, and you know, you really did a good job on that.
Well, thanks.
But talking about that, I'll ask you, any acting plans in the future, then we'll go into the directing.
Honestly, I do not have any. It's actually odd. I haven't acted now in a couple of years, I don't think. I think Man Who Came to Dinner might have been the last thing. And there's a part of me that misses it, but there's also a part of me that is content to just direct. And honestly, to give you another one of my many things that I do, I have the opportunity to work occasionally with Super Happy Productions, who does trivia shows and radio hours, and all manner of fun theater that you don't have to be off book for. And I am able to be on stage and present myself. And that kind of gets my acting Jones cooled down for a little while. So.
And what I like about that, that's very serious, dramatic, heavy roles.
Oh, absolutely, with Super Happy. It's always heavy roles.
A lot of fun.
Yeah.
Jeff, the question I ask too, and maybe I asked you the last time you were on board, but I'm always curious, that when you were a little kid, you know, did you recall being that this was going to be what you wanted to do, being an actor, director, or more an actor? When do you get
Sixth grade. Well, sixth grade, I was the proverbial troubled kid, and my sixth grade teacher took pity on me and said, "Hey, Jeff, I'm going to put on a play this year with the sixth grade. And I want you to look through this giant book of children's plays, and I want you to pick a play with enough roles for everyone, and then pick the role you want." And I was like, well, maybe this is something I can do. So I read a bunch of the plays that had enough roles, and I found one, and it had a very strong lead throughout, and I said, well, I want to play that part. And I had in my mind exactly what I wanted to do, my little kid brain. I want to do an accent, and I want to do this, and I want to do that. And so the teacher essentially let me go. Big shout out to Mr. Gioi, wherever you are. Changed my life, not necessarily for the better. But in performing that play, and, you know, like most classroom plays, we only had a few performances, one of which was for the friends and family. And the families of other kids were coming up to me and saying, hey, we loved what you did. That was so much fun. You did a great job. And it really stroked my trouble kid ego. And I was able to say, wow. This gets me some really good positive attention. This is what I want to do.
Do you remember the play?
It was called Birth of the Planets.
Do you remember that?
Yes.
I have this great idea, Jeff, I've spoken to other theater people about, is that we should have Alex Saul, for example, bring that back. You know,
bring back Birth of... I actually did find it and bring it back for one of the classes that I teach. I teach a lot of after-school classes and things like that. And I was able to find that play and bring it back for one of my groups.
How cool was that?
Yeah.
But wouldn't that be cool? Can you imagine? We do a production at Attic Salt Theater. Everybody does their first kid's play, you know?
That's a fun idea.
And especially if you had to play the kid's role. It reminds me, you ever watch The Big Bang Theory?
Mm-hmm.
You know, the show. One of the funniest shows ever was Sheldon is encouraged to take up acting, much like you. It's probably the same age. Did you see the episode?
No.
And it was such a great episode, and they're playing Annie, and he's going to play Annie, and they have to convince him you should play a, you know, it's acting is acting, Shakespeare, the whole bit. And he gets stage fright right before the show, so the guy, George and friends, George Cassanza.
Jason Alexander.
Is the drama teacher. And so he has to go out as Annie in the final scene. You know, but I could see that, you coming out and doing the first play, and we have everybody do their first plays. You know, wouldn't that be a fun thing?
That could be a lot of fun as a little experiment.
So we go from then, as a sixth grader, you're doing acting. Did it just bit you then and you continued on?
Yeah, I mean, I was definitely bit by the bug at that point, but didn't really jump into anything until high school, the town I grew up in, didn't have a lot of opportunities, so you can imagine not a lot of opportunities for kids, and was able to, in high school, get into our annual variety show, and that's what let me continue, and I started writing for that, and when I wrote my own sketches for that, the advisor would say, well, can you make that work? And that was my first experience directing. So I didn't even know what I was doing then, meaning I didn't know I was directing per se. But that was kind of my experiences there.
Did you then go on to study acting?
No, I didn't study acting. I studied on the boards, as they say. No, after high school, like most people with aspirations. I started doing community theater productions around my town and always with an eye on New York and learned little by little and eventually felt like, okay, it's time to go to New York and give it my shot.
And so then, I know we'll talk a little bit about that. You did go to New York.
I did.
And you were in New York for a bunch of years doing a bunch of things with theater. And that's when you started Axalt also?
Absolutely. I met and started dating my current partner in Axalt, Marcy Bernstein. And with a couple of other friends, we kind of, the way most theater companies begin, sat at a diner drinking way too much coffee and saying, oh, you know what show I'd love to do? You know what I'd love to do? And from those conversations became Axalt. And the other two friends eventually dropped out to pursue other things. And it left Marcy and I to continue the company. And we did so for several years in New York. And then eventually moved down here to beautiful Asheville. And
when you were with Axalt, and we'll talk about the origin of that, you did, what kinds of shows were you doing in New York?
Well, here's the odd thing. You'd think New York being such a theater town, it would be very, so many mechanisms are set up to produce theater that it would be easy to produce theater. Just the opposite is true. In fact, it's very difficult to get the rights to shows in New York, to previously produce shows in New York. The cost, just even of space rental, things like that, was just prohibitive. And so what we decided was, since we had both been kind of teaching children on the side, we said, what if we put together some children's shows that we could tour around? And we did that for a while, and we also constructed curricula for various schools and residencies. And that's what Axalt became for time, and it was able to at least put money in the bank. And it wasn't until we moved down here to Asheville that we went back to our roots, as it were, and said, hey, wait, originally we wanted to do plays that we wanted to do. And that bucket list is still being checked off. Especially with Blue Window, which is one of those original plays we wanted to do.
Well, let's talk a little bit then. So we came to Asheville then, and fortunately for us, you continued with Axalt Theater Company. And so now you produce shows, and we'll talk about some of the shows, but the one you mentioned, of course, is Blue Window, mm-hmm. and that's the current Adderall production?
That is opening tomorrow night at 7:30, so yeah, that's the current show. It's a beautiful, beautiful show written by Craig Lucas, and a very unexpected show, I like to say, because it's very difficult to describe what the show is. And when I do describe what the show is, it sounds like Seinfeld. It sounds like it's a show about nothing. It's a show about relationships and connections, but it's more thematically based than plot based, so it is very difficult to describe to the average person. Just, hey, what's the show about? It's about a dinner party, you know.
Well, I'm going to ask you about that in a second, but one of the things, again, I've liked about Adderall Productions, it seems that all the ones you do produce have some relationship aspect to it. You know, I'm thinking the couple of last ones have been fantastic, but they're all, like, Mass Appeal caught me. It's about a priest and a younger priest, and who would think that would be interesting? Boy, was that a good play.
Thanks.
So, and what, you directed that too?
Yes.
Scratch that. There was no, but no. But it's just anything you've done. I think both performing and acting, I've enjoyed. But that was like relationships. So let's go to this one. This is so it's a bunch of people are sitting around in there.
It's essentially it's a three scene play, and the first scene is five different apartments with seven people who are getting ready to go to this dinner party that is being thrown by Libby. And the second scene is everybody sitting in the Libby's living room and enjoying hors d'oeuvres and drinks before dinner. And then the third scene goes back to the apartments and is everybody's individual results of the dinner party, how they came away, what they took from the other people they met and things like that. The interesting thing is, like I said, it's very theme-based. It's not plot-based. So, yeah, you could say, well, it's about people getting ready for a dinner party. Then it's about people having a dinner party. Then it's about people home after the dinner party.
Well, that describes it. And, yeah. And as you say, it's kind of interesting because that doesn't inherently sound like a really interesting
exactly
play. But one of the nice things also about it, it's going to be the first time, right, we've done a play actually at the actual theater?
Yeah, actually in the studio.
Facility.
We used, we had our kids' shows went up at our studio, and then very recently we did Man from Earth, which actually was set outside our studio around a campfire, and that was a joy as well. But this is the first main stage Adderall production happening at our studio.
And talk about where the studio is.
Studio's at 2002 Riverside Drive. It's an old textile factory currently called The Mill at Riverside. And they've turned it into a bunch of studios. And most of the studios in the building are manufacturers, but they're very cool manufacturers. Like we've got a yurt guy there, and we've got a toy company downstairs, and a group that makes baby clothes right across the hall from us. It's a very interesting, cool building, and everybody who comes there is kind of taken by it, and especially since it retains some of its textile factory charm, if you can call it that, but then once you walk into the studio, you're like, oh my goodness, it's like beautiful in here.
And one of the great things about coming to the studio is there's great parking. You know, that you don't have to fight Asheville, you don't have to pay for Asheville parking, no traffic going to the place. It's a real pleasure when you have that.
Yes, free parking is what, we don't care if you want to see our shows, just come for the free parking. It's actually, there's parking in the front of the building, and then there's a huge parking lot in the rear of the building, and one of the things in doing shows that every company worries about is, are people going to come due to something that's seemingly petty like parking, but it's very important when you have to drive everywhere and, you know, you have to worry about it. And luckily, when we produce, on the weekends and in the evenings, all the manufacturers are gone. So the lot is essentially ours.
And it's a pleasure to get in and out of, you know, and there's signage in the back now. We have where you can find the studio. But encourage people to check it out. Another reason they should check it out, Jeff, though, is because for this particular show, you put together, I think, one of the most amazing casts I've seen in Nashville.
Oh, we didn't mess around with this.
And talk about who's in this play.
Okay, I can really call every single actor in this play the incomparable. Because, to us, it's an all-star cast. I feel like to Asheville, it's an all-star cast. We've got the great acting and directing couple of Scott Keel and Trinity Smith Keel. Scott's just coming off of his very successful acting gig over at NC Stage with Frost Nixon and Trinity.
And boy, did you get to see that, by the way?
I did get to see
that. What a great show that was. Yeah.
Yes. And Trinity is coming off of Miss Nelson is Missing down at Flat Rock. So, and I've had the opportunity to work with both of them in different capacities in the past, and they're so wonderful to work with and do a bang-up job with their roles. I also have kind of, she's becoming the Fontaine to my Lunt, I think, or is it the other way around? I don't know. But she, Christy Montestioca, who I cast always and in everything. She always does an amazing job on stage, and she's such a joy to work with off stage, as well as two other actors that Attic Salt has worked with in the past to great success. That is Josephine Thomas and Henry Williamson. And
it's amazing you have these couples now coming into.
Well, Josephine and Henry aren't a couple anymore.
Oh,
I don't know if
that.
I'm revealing
okay.
too much.
We'll
here,
mention
but,
that.
But
they still perform together?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, good.
And they work so great together. And both of them, I mean, I don't think they share much stage time together in this play, but they're both doing amazing things with their roles. And then we've got two newcomers to Attic Salt. As a matter of fact, newcomers, people that I have never seen before. So we tried to cast as many roles as we can based on the first read-through we did with the play. However, there were a couple of roles that remained open, and we held auditions for them. And as Tom, we got Edwin Glass.
Don't know him
who,
yet.
No, we didn't know him either. And he came in, and the character had to play guitar, and here was this guy coming in with the guitar, looked the role, but is doing just amazing stuff. And then in what I think is the most difficult role in the show, as Emily, is Amanda Klinikowski. And I know she's done some work out at Hart.
And I saw her at Hart. She was terrific in that role, small role. And then I missed the other show she was in, but talented actress also, talented actor. Yeah.
Yeah, she is just fantastic.
And it's exciting, too, because a lot of people don't know her. And even Henry is mostly out in Hart, does a lot of stuff in Hart. So it's nice to bring him into this area.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And then, of course, you have the incomparable seventh person is Alan.
No.
Alan's not in this?
No, I named Trinity
Scott.
Oh,
the
Scott.
Six. Okay,
yeah,
great.
Yeah, yeah, Trinity Scott, Christy, Henry, Joe, Amanda, and Edwin. That's seven. That's our seven people.
I always admired not only you, but any director, in terms of that must be the toughest thing to do, casting it, you know. And to your credit, you almost always seem to get it right. You know, the cast is so important. And I've never, with one exception, seen one of your plays and said, hey, that's not a perfect person for the part, you know?
Was it me? Did I cast myself?
no comment. But let me ask you this. Well, it's also the one play you mentioned. There were just so many people in that play, you know. That was the Man Who Came to the Net. Had how many parts in that?
Oh,
play?
I don't know. I think there were 30. I mean, it was insane.
Big role. Is that tough as a director? having to not only cast, but to tell people they don't get the role?
Telling people they don't get the role is, yeah, one of those necessary evils of directing. No one likes doing that. One thing I like to tell when I'm teaching acting is, please, please, please remember that when you go into the audition room and throughout the casting process, the director is on your side. You know, a lot of people feel like it's an adversarial relationship. It's not. I want you to be great. I want you to get that part. I want you to make my work difficult as far as casting goes. So I'm never sitting there thinking, I don't want that person to do well. I want everyone to do great and make my job difficult and make me even rethink a role.
Right.
Because that's something that was a joy to do. I say Emily is one of the most difficult roles in this play. A lot of that was discovered because the casting process was so difficult. I had a number of really terrific actresses come in and read for it, and then I called back a good number of them because some of them were just phenomenal. And in doing that, I had to sit there and parse the role. And this is before we ever delved into the table work of the play. But I had to sit there and parse the role and decide, okay, where is she coming from and what does she want, and be able to convey that to the actors so that I could find the absolute best person for that role.
For folks not knowledgeable, describe the process of the show, putting on the show. In other words, it's like a Mickey Rooney, Judy Garland thing. You know, you just get together and let's put on a show.
Oh, yeah. You find a space. Yeah. You assemble a cast. You drink a lot of whiskey. And then you basically say, just get on stage and run around and do stuff.
How long are rehearsals?
I usually like to dedicate at least 40 hours to a straight play and 80 hours to a musical. The 80 hours is often not necessary to put a musical up, but necessary for the sanity of all, because there are so many moving parts to it. But with this play, when all is said and done, we will have put in about 50 total hours of rehearsal time over the course of a month. And it's different for every play. You can never say this is the process, because you never know what's going to come up and how things are going to change. And it's really interesting for me every time to see not only where the problems are, but where the solutions are to those problems.
Is any play, quote, easy to put on?
Huh. That's a good question. Yeah, those are the ones you worry about the most. when you're in the process and everything is going smooth and it feels easy, all of a sudden you're kind of, oh my, something's got to be wrong. Something's going wrong here. I don't know what it is, but something's going to crash.
That somebody a week before says they can't do the
role. Says they can't do the role. It's like, this is going way too easy. Something's going to happen here. But even when it feels easy and then it turns out to be a success, that's, you know, somewhat of a blessing. However, when people ask me why do you prefer directing over acting, is because the feeling that I seek as a director is much more easily attainable than the feeling I seek as an actor. As an actor, I'm constantly seeking a feeling, what's come to be called flow, being in the zone, that shut off your brain thing and everything just clicks. And as an actor, it's very hard to attain that. You hear it a lot referred to athletes, but it's actually more prevalent in factory workers and people who do assembly work and do the same thing over and over. They are suddenly able to shut off their brain and have this feeling of flow. And then 8 hours later, someone says, hey, stop working now. And they go, oh, man, I was just in the zone. So as an actor, that's what I seek, and it's very difficult to attain. However, as a director, I am seeking that moment when a thing that you and the actor and maybe the set or a prop or a costume and the lighting and the sound and all those things just come together for that one moment and they click, and it's exactly the moment you wanted to see.
If folks want to see if, in fact, you accomplish that moment, to see...
I have twice.
Okay, but let's talk about it to see the current show. It's going to be playing when and where, and information.
Blue Window is going to be playing starting tomorrow, December 6th, through December 16th. It's going to be Thursdays, Fridays, and Saturdays at 7:30 p.m., and Sundays at 2:30 p.m. We have matinees for this show. You can get tickets now by going to atticsalt.org. That's attic like the top of a house, salt like the condiment.org. And get your tickets there. They are, I can't say how much they are. I forgot that rule. but you can get all the information right there. And the shows will be presented up at our studio at 2002 Riverside Drive, Studio 42O. And it's just a beautiful play, and we're so proud to present this bucket list play in our studio.
And I look forward to seeing you then next couple of days, Jeff, at the show, and lots of luck with it. Thanks for coming on board this first half hour.
Thank you so much, Blaine. Really appreciate you.
Okay, and we're going to do something a little bit different as Jeff works his way out of the studio. And what we're going to do differently is go off Facebook Live, because our second guest, if all goes well, is going to be a radio interview. So hopefully you'll stay listening if you're listening on the radio. And we'll see you in just a bit if this